Hello and welcome to Catholic Alpha's Marriage Unchained. I want to tell you a little bit about myself, but before I do, I want to show you this. This is one of my favorite saints. His name is Saint Michael the Archangel. He's above a regular angel. And if you look close, he has a demon, his foot on top of a demon's head, and he's ready with his divine sword to take care of this evil. And evil and bad things are basically the same, because I know you might have been brought up in the secular society and not understand some. We have been these days have been taught that evil doesn't really exist. And I want to let you know and to inform you that it does, and in the way that it is. And you ask, why would I have Saint Michael here with me? And the reason is because we need the protection of our Lord in our marriages, especially you as a man. You are getting evil and bad things, crazy things thrown at you every day. And you are probably a strong man, but a lot of times in your life, you see that no matter how hard you fight, it's not good enough. And your marriage is going bad. The kids are crazy. And that is God letting you know that you need him. So, that being said, we have to ignite the protection of Saint Michael, and I want him here so that you can understand that evil is in your marriage and you need God to help you to battle that. And that's why Saint Michael is here. Now, away from that, let me tell you a little bit about myself and my marriage and my little journey to Catholic Alpha and Marriage Unchained, my course. First of all, I love being married. There is nothing in this world that has been given to me and I've been blessed by. And I hated how in our society how a man being married is looked upon as not significant, or men that are married, their marriages are so bad or even marginal that they want to dog out and criticize everybody else that is in marriage. So what that does when we as men do that, that puts a bad name on marriage, and then that starts to destroy your marriage, and which makes your marriage crap. So my trial, well, I was a senior in high school and having sex. And I was dating a girl and we were having sex and throughout high school, and in our senior year, she got pregnant. Well, I was already enlisted in the Air Force and was scheduled to leave. And so I couldn't really be there. I mean, 'cause once you enlist, you're gone. So one day I went over her house, and I cared about her and she cared about me. And somehow, I don't even know what happened, we got into an argument. And for the life of me, thinking back, I just don't even remember what it was about. But basically, I left mad and I didn't see her for months. The next time that I heard from her, she had a baby. And that day, that I felt really sad about that. You know, my parents didn't know, my sister didn't know, nobody knew, and I hadn't told anybody. So I felt at the time that I thought about it, and I thought that maybe we should get married. Anyway, so the next time I came home, I had thought in my head, I thought, well, it'd be a good time. I mean, I thought I was getting married. So this is my test of character, my first major test of character. And so I get home. I tell him right on the plane, I decide, you know what, I'm going to ask her to marry me. So I get home, I go out and buy a ring, and I don't tell anybody about it. And when we, so on the day that I planned it out, I told her I was coming over. I enlisted my pops to help me to take me over. And he didn't know my plans to ask her to marry me. So it's raining, it's pouring down raining. And we're riding in the car, and it's just like, I mean, I still feel like it's just about yesterday. You know, it's like yesterday. And so I tell my father, I said, Pops, I pull out the ring, and I show it to him. I said, Pops, I'm thinking about asking my girlfriend to marry me. And if you have to know my father, I mean, he is the coolest dude. But, and so he said, he looked at me, he said it for like about 10 or 15 seconds, and he goes, son, I don't think that's a good move. And I go, you know, it's my father, so I don't like really say anything disrespectful. I'm thinking in my head, but isn't that what I'm supposed to do? I mean, I have a girl pregnant. If I'm man enough to do that, I should be man enough to take care of business. So my father goes, well, that's not a smart move. And I said, what do you mean, Dad, that's not a smart move? He said, well, just because you have a girl pregnant doesn't mean you have to marry him. And so that was my first really indoctrination into our society and how cold and how crazy that we could be. And so basically during that night, I go over to her house. I don't bring the ring out and I don't ask her to marry me. And that over the years has really caused a rift. I haven't spoken to her. I really haven't spoken to, you know, anybody. And I felt bad about that. But I don't blame my father because, you know, he was just a man. He had our family. He had me, my sister, and my mom. And he just didn't really know. I mean, he just doing the best. He was giving me the best advice that he knew how to give. And then you have to understand, he came from the 60s. He grew up in the 60s, and it was like, what, free love, free sex, whatever you want to do, like, which the 60s has turned us into this. It's terrible. It's really bad now. So, I mean, I don't really blame him. That's just what he was taught. That's how he grew up. That was my decision. So then my first marriage, my first wife, we met in Portales, New Mexico. I was in the Air Force. I was having a great old time. I just came from basic training. I hadn't had any dates. So my friends asked me and say, hey, let's go up to the college. So we go up to the college. We all pack in. We go up to the college. And I see we're drinking and having a good old time. And I see this woman walk by. Well, we're kids, really. I mean, I'm 19, 18. And I see this woman walk by. She has on a pink pants, and she has on a pinkish white blouse, long black hair, beautiful skin color. And she has on the back of her shirt, she has her name. And I said, hey, Renee, come here. I don't know this girl from nothing, man. I don't know this girl from nothing. So I go, hey, Renee, come here. And she turns around and looks at me, and I look at her, and I said, you want to dance? And that's what we did. We danced for 4 straight hours, and we hit it off. So then after a few months, we move in together. Bad move, Jerry. Bad move. You don't move in. You don't cohabitate. Because when you cohabitate, that screws up your marriage. Okay? If you first of all, when you get married and you cohabitate, then you think you're married, but you're not. You're cohabitating with some woman. You're using her. I mean, I didn't know that at the time. And that is one of the reasons why through our marriage, I had big problems. But we'll go into that into another. I know that's in the course. Go over to that. But anyway, so we moved in together, and we received. So then we lived together for about a year, and then I received orders to go over to Guam. Which, for you who don't know, that's Guam. That's over in the Pacific Ocean. It's a small island, about 8 miles by 12 miles. It's a really beautiful tropical place. So I told her, again, the rain. We sit in my car in front of my barracks, and I go, you know, she doesn't know that I have orders to leave. So I get in her, put her in the car, and I say, I don't think we should get married. So, of course, her being a sweet woman, she starts crying and going through all that. So I'm feeling bad, and I'm not manning up. I mean, think about it. I slept with this girl for 2 years, a year. We living together. I'm just about me. I don't tell her, you know, she loves me and I care about her. But when it comes down to make the big decision, what do I do? Same old stuff. Stuff you learn. You say, I don't have to get married, you know, whatever. So luckily, I have to, before I go over to Guam, I have to go to training. Training over in Shreveport, Louisiana. So I get in my car, I drive down there, and the whole time I'm there, I'm really missing her. And I think at the time, even when you're dumb, God still works on you. So I'm sitting there thinking, okay, I'm going to leave this woman. I spent this time with her. And that's the thing about me. I'm a one-woman man. I love women, but I'm a one-woman man. So I don't really like the two women at one time type deal. So I'm down there, and I'm thinking about her. So what do? I say, screw it. I'm going to call her, and I ask her to come to Shreveport, and she comes down, which makes me know that she still loves me. So she comes down, and I buy a ring, and we go to this French restaurant, and no, it's a weeknight. And it was funny, for our whole years of marriage, she would always say, oh, my husband was so wonderful. He rented out the whole restaurant just to propose to me. And I told her, look, I did not rent out the restaurant. It was a weekday. There wasn't nobody in there. But, of course, a woman, you can't tell her nothing. She don't believe you. She wants to dream that that's how romantic I was. So after a while, what do? As a man, you say, you forget about it. Okay. So after that, we get married. We get married by just another piece. And that was another bad move. Get married by just to the peace. You don't have anybody around. Anybody telling me how to do this. We don't tell our parents. She don't tell her parents. And we're getting married. We get two of our friends to be witnesses. And that's it. I mean, so basically we get married. We don't have any graces from God. We don't have any sacrament. We don't have that grace. And starting off bad. But when you're young and dumb, what do? You do what you want. You don't listen to your parents. You don't listen to anybody. You just think that love is going to carry you through. Well, that's dumb. Okay? I'm here to tell you, that's dumb. And if you are an older person and you have kids, you know exactly what I'm talking about. In Guam, our marriage, it was weak. You know, we go to Guam. She comes to Guam with our first son. She's pregnant. She gets off the airplane, and her stomach is like 2 feet from her body. And we're in love. We there. I was happy I married her. She was happy she married me. And for 3 years in Guam, we were, you know, we loved each other. We were together. It was no family around to screw things up. It was just me and her in the military. But toward the end of that stint in Guam, things started going bad. She messed around on me. I messed around on her. Just dumb stuff that you don't really even know why you're doing these things. I mean, as a woman, she felt that I wasn't paying enough attention to her. And as me, I'm like, I gotta go to work. We get mad at each other. I'm going off to Australia for a temporary assignment. I'm looking at the women. The women are looking at me. I'm like 19, 20 years old. I mean, it's just ridiculous. And, but looking back on those times, I really regret the man I was. And that is probably, you know, I feel men are, we're responsible for loving our wives and cherishing them. And even at 20, 25 years old, whatever old I was, I know that what I was doing wasn't right. And, of course, what she was doing wasn't right. But we're not here to talk about our wives. We're here to talk about us and me. I need to fix me. And when I fix me, then things seem to work out better. So we leave Guam, and we move to Fort Worth, Texas. That's my next duty assignment. And as you can see, we're moving. I'm moving my family all over the place. And that's how the military gets old. It gets old real quick. I mean, it's beautiful. You're having fun. You hanging out with your friends. You know, either together was just me and my wife and my son. And things are going, you know, they're better. But, I mean, the military will move you around. So after a while, you have to decide what you're going to do. So our second son is born. And things get better for a little bit. But I mean, we just don't have God. We don't have any mission. We don't have any goals. We don't have anything. And we just have each other. And that's great, but you need more than just each other when you're trying to keep a family together. You need God. And we didn't have that. And so we're just aimless. We're just out there. We're doing what we thought was the right thing to do. We don't have our parents around. Only mentorship we had was just other people in the military. Well, we all know how that works. Military, just like police officers. I mean, jokers are getting married, divorced, just like that. I mean, it's we are nothing. I mean, you married today, gone tomorrow. That's how that works. So, I'm about ready to get out of the military. My enlistment is almost up, and so me and my wife sit down and talk, and we go, well, where are we gonna move? You know, I've been in the military almost 10 years, in the Air Force almost 10 years. I feel I've grown as far as I could grow in that situation. And so we decide we're gonna move to, well, we decide, I thought we were deciding together, but our wives love us so much, they kind of just kind of go about what we want to do. And so me being young and dumb, what do I say? Oh, no, we don't move back to New Mexico, where her mom is, her sisters are, her cousins are, all her family. We don't move there. We move. I say, we're going to move back to Indianapolis. What do you think about that, honey? And of course, what does she say? Oh, yeah, baby, let's move to Indianapolis. You haven't been near your family for all these years, because we were in New Mexico for a long time, and we would go back to her home when we went on vacation and stuff. We hardly didn't go back to my place in Indianapolis. But anyway, I'm here to tell you, bad move. Bad, bad move. Like my father used to say, son, that's a bad move. And that was the dumbest move I ever did. I'm thinking I'm going to come back to Indianapolis. I'm going to bring my wife and my family, and everything's going to be peachy keen. Well, no. You never, ever, ever, ever take your wife away from her family. Because as soon as you got to work 10, 12 hours a day, your wife is there by herself. She, even if she's working, what happens is the ladies that she's working with, girl, where's your husband at? What, he's doing what, girl? If that was you, I wouldn't be doing that. And that's exactly what happens. Your wife feeling unloved and uncherished and insecure, she starts listening to them crazy women that probably don't have husbands themselves. She starts listening to them. And then what happens is she starts doing what they do. Going out, you're at work or you're doing your deal, and I'm working 12 hours a day, sometimes more. And she comes from work. She goes out with them to the clubs, hanging out with them. And what starts to happen? You know, she starts getting attention from other places. And that's why it's so very important that we are in tune with our wives, because they need our attention. That's what they married us for. They didn't marry us for us to be putting work ahead of them or money ahead of them. Your relationship with your wife is the most important relationship on this earth, even above your kids. And I, at what, 28, 29 years old, I just didn't realize that. And that's when our problems really, really started when we get here. It lasted for a little while. And we did have a lot of good times in our marriage. We loved each other. My wife cared about me, but every time we get home, we're home, every time she get upset and she get on the airplane and just start running back to New Mexico where her family is. And that's what happens. I'm sitting here wondering, I come home, where the wife, where the kids? Well, they didn't get on the airplane, left me, I'm by myself. And I'm very, you know, and at that age, I just didn't understand, and I didn't have anybody to really guide me on how to be a good husband. And most these days, none of us are taught how to even be a good husband or a good father. But you have to be a good husband first so that you can be a good father. You have to love God first and do what he says, that submit and be obedient to him, so that all that love and all those graces move to your wife and your marriage. And then your wife will flow, all her love will flow to your children and to everybody else she meets. That's how it works. That's why God says in Ephesians 5, be women, wives, be submit to your husbands the way Christ gave himself for the church. That's what a man's supposed to do. Submit, protect, give your life for your wife. And when you do that and you love her like Christ loved the church, she will just blossom. And so, anyway, so we're having problems. She leaves me, and we're still married, but we're separated. And a few months later, I don't think it was a year. Come to find out, she's really weak, and everybody, she thought she had pneumonia, but it wasn't pneumonia. It was leukemia. And That was it. Lost my first wife. That was the bad thing. And only thing I remember, how hard the funeral was, and me and the boy sitting on the couch, and I had to talk to him about how sick their mom is, and I remember how we would go visit her at the hospital, and the last time we walked into the hospital, we were going to visit her, and luckily I was ahead of the boys, and I turn around to go into the hospital room, and the nurses, one on each side of her arm, and she's up, she's bald headed, she has an eye patch, a black eye patch on her eye, and she's flailing, delirious. I mean, because all the drugs she's on, and that's the thing about doctors, they experimented on my wife. I mean, sometimes I just think you just gotta let a person die. I mean, why are you gonna cut my wife's hair off? Why are you gonna take her eye? Why are you gonna do all this stuff? I mean, let the woman die with dignity around her family and just do that. I mean, I don't understand. I didn't understand that. But that's what happens when you don't have God and Christ, because you think that you don't know that this life isn't it. So you don't have that mission. You don't have that faith, that knowledge, that certainty that you just die with dignity with your family, and you tell them you love them. You spend time together. I mean, basically my wife's in the hospital for the last month or whatever. She's doped up on drugs and we can't even hardly talk to her. So luckily when we went to the hospital that last time, you know, I stopped them. No, it's the second to last time. I stopped them and because I didn't want the boys to see her like that. So I grabbed them, but right before they came around the corner, and I told them to stay there, and we walked out of the hospital. because I knew at that time it wasn't nothing that we could have done. I mean, it wasn't nothing, no need to trying to see her or nothing. So then the last time we went to the hospital, she was in the bed and she was out, eye patch on her, and basically she was getting ready to die. I mean, that was it. And the boys, and I let them see her, and you know, we all three, we held her hand and we cried, and her mom was sitting there and stuff, and that's just the way it was. So then I had to go to New Mexico. All the boys went to New Mexico. My wife, she was Native American, so we went to New Mexico, went on the Indian reservation, and the next thing I know, we're standing in front of this hole, dust, New Mexico dust blowing all around us, and the boys are standing next to me, and we're looking down in the hole, and they lowered her, and that was it. That was it. So now, that was the end of that. So now we go to my second marriage, and we get together. I don't know. One day, I'm going through the mall, and I see her, and she jumps up, and I go, "Oh, she sees me." The thing about my second wife is we met at 12 years old at a day camp. So we kind of went out. We were boyfriend and girlfriend for years, except when I got in high school, for on and off in high school a little bit. But then we separated when I went to the Air Force, of course. And so then she comes up to me, and I hadn't seen her in years, and I'm like, "Wow!" So we hug each other, and we start talking, and we make plans to see each other that night, because my sister was having a little get together, so we decided we're gonna go over there. Now, my wife is, you know, she's a special kind of lady. She goes, she always teases me and goes, like, "That was our first date." And I'm like, "No, that was not a date. That was just two friends getting together, going over to my sister's house to hang out." Now, she's saying that was a date. Now, I'm saying it wasn't a date. So we argue about that all the time. So, of course, as a man, we're going to say that wasn't no date. But as a woman, they're going to say that is a date. So we'll just agree or disagree on that. But anyway, so... we do what people do. We date for a while, and what do? We move in together. Dumb again. Our kids, we move in together. But the thing about me and my wife, at least I had enough sense to propose to her, to give her a ring. We had a date. So the last 6 months or a year or something like that, we lived together with the kids in the same house, just dumb, stupid stuff. I mean, now our kids are corrupted. This doesn't make sense. I mean, I'm 30-something years old. I should know better. But no, that's not what I do. The thing about cohabitating is, and having sex before you're married, and having sex together before you're married, is that builds up defenses that helps destroy your marriage when you are married. Those defenses are built up in each of us. And when things start going wrong, we have all these skeletons in our closet, and that is input onto our wives, and our wives put things up onto us. So basically, when me and my wife get married, the odds of us even, now looking back, knowing what I know today, the odds of us even making it, though many years ago, were so slim, but we made it. Both of us had divorced parents, and we had no examples of good marriages to even go by. So in the society today, everybody wants to get a divorce, and the ones that are married act like they're happy, and they're not. Most folks are married and just surviving and just getting along. I mean, and they don't talk, they don't spend time together, they're trying to stay away from each other. but they perpetrate, act like they are happy, and they're not. So the people that really are truly have and good are so slim, those types of marriages are so slim that no one of the kids want to get married. So all we had divorced parents, we had premarital sex. I mean, me and my wife were so dumb, especially me, we even did contraception inside of our marriage. So we're taking birth control inside our marriage. How dumb is that? You know, contraception, just so you know a little bit about it, it stops you from giving your total self to your spouse. So if she's taking the pill or has on a diaphragm or has a thing or I'm putting on the rubber, whatever, then because we don't want to have babies, because having a baby is selfish. So we're just thinking about ourselves. So when you contracept, you're basically, that is a selfish thing. So that's kind of how that went. We decided to get married. I proposed, and first thing I told myself was, I'm gonna try my best not to screw this up. I screwed up my first marriage, and I'm gonna try to screw this up. But once we got married, we encountered a lot of problems as newlyweds. We tried to be foster parents. Another dumb move. How you going to be a newlywed and be a foster parent? You got all these kids around. I've already got 5 kids on my own. Well, at that time, it was 4 kids. Well, my fourth kid was just born. So we got 5 kids in the house. Then we're trying to bring these other kids in that are foster kids, and they got all their problems. You know, so my kids are understanding why these kids are here. I mean, it was just ridiculous. But when you're young, 30s is still young, you don't really realize all the evil and all the bad things and the arrows as a man that you're getting every day. And basically, the same stuff started happening in my second marriage that was happening in my first marriage. The same stuff. We weren't spending time together. I'm working all the time. My wife's working. We're trying to make money. We're trying to raise the kids. We're trying to bring another kids together, our kids together. And, you know, but the great thing about it, that our kids is, they are troopers. None of them got pregnant in high school. None of them, they all got through high school, going to college and things like that. So we have really good kids. But what I realized was that as a man, things were just coming so fast. I mean, I couldn't solve everything. You know, this happened with the kids. Things happened with me and my wife. The foster parent thing. My daughter's grandmother. Just all these things just started happening. And then on top of that, I hurt my Achilles at a football game. I hurt my Achilles, so I don't get to work for a year. Just crazy stuff. All this stuff is happening in my marriage, and I'm thinking, what am I doing? What am I going to do? I mean, and basically what's happening is all these things are coming so fast. They're all coming so fast, I can't solve them all. I just keep thinking, as long as I can do it by myself, as long as I keep fighting and persevering and all this, I can get it. I can solve it. You know, I can solve this for my wife. I can do this for the kids. I can do this for myself. Dude, I was losing the fight and losing battle. Losing battle, losing battle, losing battle. So finally, what I realized is marriage takes 3. And once I started bringing God and Christ into the marriage and the Holy Spirit, I just can't express to you how things were different. I mean, problems that I would get, they were gone. I mean, things started coming in a manageable way. And see, the problem is sometimes when evil is in your presence or bad things are happening and you're miserable, your family's terrible, your wife is unhappy, you're unhappy. Sometimes you feel so bad or things are going so bad that you don't even know you're miserable. You don't even know your wife's unhappy because you don't even talk to her. And that's what's wrong with the men. We do not talk. We don't spend, I mean, really talk to your wife every day. Sit down, hold her, talk to her, have a best friend conversation with your wife every day. It should be natural. But what do I mean? We want to talk to our buddies. We want to go watch sports. We want to go hang out. We want to do everything we're going to go do. We do everything to stay away from our beloved. And I'm telling you, God is just going to allow bad things to happen. He's not going to protect you. See, St. Michael, dude. He's just going to say, St. Michael, look, they're choosing evil. They're choosing Satan. They're choosing bad things. They're going to do things their way. So we're just going to allow the stuff to happen. And when you're miserable, you don't even know it. And the thing about it is when you're happy and you have God in your life and things are going great, you forget what bad was. So sometimes you start reverting back to your bad way. And that's where prayer comes in. But that's a whole nother thing. I don't want to waste no more time on that. I don't want to waste your time on that. But that's covered in the course too. But once I realized and brought God into our marriage and made him number one and made him the force, things just started happening in our life that would never have happened before. My wife became happier, fulfilled, the kids, I mean me, everything, the gut, the emptiness in my gut. Like, now I have a mission. I understand what I'm supposed to be. I understand what I'm supposed to do, the man I'm supposed to be, God's plan for me. And some of you are like, you know, I'm sorry, you might be like a person, God's plan. Look, man, it's just that when you turn your life over, a lot of pressures that you normally would have, you give them to God and let him deal with them, and he helps guide you with prayer, everything. So once I did that with my wife, I mean, our life just changed. Everything stopped coming so fast. Everything slowed down. I started meeting other Christian brothers, and we all have the same problems. We come together, and we come together as Christian brothers, and we talk about these things, and we deal with them. See, that's another thing. You can't talk about religion at work. You can't talk about the Father at work. You can't talk about the Father anywhere. So guess what? You don't even know who really thinks like you. That's all a thing to keep God out of the square, public square. Pretty soon you ain't gonna be able to pray in your own home. But we as men, we're too dumb to see it. It's slowly happening. So one time, so moving on, we started getting our marriage together a little better, and my wife, something weird happened. My wife stopped having sexual desires. Her sexual drive started diminishing. Now, eventually, she didn't even want sex at all. Now, as a man, I'm thinking, what's wrong? Basically, my wife no longer even desired me as a husband, or not as a husband, but as a man. What I mean is, she didn't even, to me, that's where I looked at it. She didn't even desire me as a man. So to me, that was huge. I mean, that was a huge deal. I'm married to my wife. We love each other, and she's not even thinking about sex. There's a problem. So I figured it was her problem, not mine. We talked about it. She said, look, baby, I'm gonna go try to figure it out. I might be going to menopause, or, you know, we, you know, another dumb thing we did. She sterilized herself, and she got her tubes tied after our last son. That was another dumb thing. I mean, you sterilize yourself, and you think, as a man too, your wife sterilizes herself, and we think we're so selfish and stupid. We think that's not going to affect our wives, her psyche, her connection with the Father, her connection with the other children, her connection with me. We think that because we're just thinking about, oh, wow, no more babies. No, we don't have no more babies. I ain't got to take care of nothing. I ain't got to do nothing. Oh, that's going to save money. But that's another dumb thing we do. You know, we're so selfish, we don't even realize that the children are a blessing. The more children you have, you know, there's a study out that it's been found recently that the more children you have, the more chance you are of staying together as a married couple, the happier you are. But secular world tells you what? They tell you, oh, you only want two kids, man. And if you start having more than two kids, are you crazy? Like when me and my wife got married, I stood up at the priest and said, look, I want as many kids as I can have. And then my wife was, everybody in the whole church was laughing. But that's what I meant. But then, you know, she started having problems with our second son. And I thought, you know, but sometimes you just got to let God take care of things. And you have as many kids that God allows. Basically, after I thought that the sexual problem was hers, so I stepped away and said, look, you figure it out, which I did. I looking back, that probably wasn't a smart move either, but I figured she's a woman. That's a woman problem. I mean, I felt okay. She didn't. So, I figured maybe, you know, that was a woman thing. Let her go to the doctor, let her do this and do that. After that, basically we went into a low sex marriage, just like my first marriage. Because when you start having problems, one of the things that starts happening, sex starts pulling back. You don't have sex as much. If you don't have sex, you don't feel connected. You're married. You people try to act like sex is not a big deal, man, but sex is a huge deal. That is how God shows us his love for us. That is just a small bit of divine love. And when a married couple has sex and has the marital act, that is God's way of showing them his love for them and his blessing for their marriage. And when you're not having sex with your wife, you're going to have problems. You just are. So at the time, I didn't know that, though. I thought it was her problem. I thought that's what she had to do, something she had to fix. And I was like, cool, you know. So my wife started looking around for all this help. And she's made a schedule for a sex doctor, but she didn't go. So after a while, you know, 3 or 4 months, I started realizing the problem was getting worse. So what I did was I said, okay, babe, do you mind if I start looking around? She's like, cool, that's fine. So that's what happened. So I took on the mission. And basically, once I started researching, I started finding out, everybody said the same stuff about sex, the same old stuff. These people don't know nothing. They don't know nothing about the marriage, about marital sex, about the marriage act. They don't know about intimacy. They don't know. All they keep trying to do is tell you the same old dumb stuff, you know, that the secular world is trying to tell you. God isn't even in the stuff that they're talking about. So basically they don't know what the heck they're doing. And that was making me upset, in that this is 2011 or 2010 or whatever, and people don't know any more about sex than they did 50 or 100 years ago. They still spouting the same crap. Psychologists trying to tell you all this stuff. They're not married. Their marriage is just screwed up, but they're trying to tell you. Just like these people come and try to tell you how to raise your kids now. And none of them got kids, or they're not even married. You know, they got a kid over here with somebody, and the woman got a kid over here with somebody, but they're going to tell you what you shouldn't do with your kids, and you married, and you got a family. That does not make sense to me. Why do we listen to people that don't know anything? You know, that's why if you're a single woman, why are you talking to other single women? Why are they talking to other single women about their marriage? You're like you're married, and you're talking to your single buddies or people that have screwed up marriages. You're talking to them about your marriage. That does not make any sense to me whatsoever. So anyway, I researched. It took me about 3 or 4 months. And what I found out, I came across a doctor and on the internet, and I found out that it was me. My wife's sexual problem was all me. And I'm thinking, how the heck is it me? I mean, I felt good. I felt fine. I don't understand. I just didn't understand. So I studied and I learned that basically we weren't having sex long enough. In a nutshell, that's just it. We weren't having sex long enough. My wife wasn't having enough orgasms. And so you might be saying, what? The problem is this. Women take like 20 minutes at least to warm up. So I don't mean warm up like caressing and all that. I mean, after foreplay, women take like 20 minutes to warm up, which means you have to be inserted in your wife for at least 20 minutes for her to even get warmed up. So if most men, we're done in what, 5 minutes, 15 minutes? I mean, we're done. And I'm not talking about foreplay and beforehand. I'm talking about actually making love. We're usually done in 15 minutes at the most. I mean, come on, let's just be honest with yourself. I mean, be real. And so what's happening is if our wife's body says that they need 30 minutes or 20 minutes or an hour or 2 hours or 3 hours or 4 hours, and we're done in 15 minutes or 5 minutes or 2 minutes, there's a problem. The ad don't add up, does it? It doesn't add up. The math just isn't there. So that's kind of where we're going. That's kind of my journey. Today, I have the best marriage in the world. My wife is happy. She's fulfilled. She's secure. She feels loved. She feels cherished. And like I told my friend the other night, my job is to love my wife so hard that she has to tell me to back off. To give her so much love and to show her that she is the most important thing in this world to me. Even more than my kids. Even more, especially my mama and my daddy and my friends. Them relationships are 10th, 4th, 5th. My wife, because without your wife, you have nothing. She is your helpmate. She's part of you. That's why God took her from the center rib. Not up here, not down here, from the middle, to let you know your wife is equal. Y'all are partners. Y'all are together. So I want you to know that in Marriage Unchained, I can get you to where you need to be. That's just the bottom line. You don't have to listen to me, but I'd advise you to. All the things I've been through in these last 30 years, that's knowledge. I can teach you how to be a strong Christian, masculine man. I can teach you how to find out what God has in plan in store for you. I can teach you, instruct you, and mentor you on how to be the man that God's calling you to be. I can mentor you on how to be the man your wife needs, not the man she wants. Ooh. And when you have a stellar marriage like I have, people are always talking to you. People are always wanting to know how you're doing it. They look at your wife, and your wife is spreading love all over to the kids. Your children are fulfilled. Your children are flourishing. They're happy. Your family is great. Because when your wife is happy and you love her the way she needs to be loved, she will reward you by making your family the best family in the world. She will spread her love and your love together throughout the generations of your kids, your kids' kids, their kids. That's how important our decisions are. That's how important what we do as men is. So I've been talking for a while now. I just want you to know a little bit about me and a little bit about my family so that you can understand where I'm coming from. You can understand why I do what I do and why I'm passionate about the men in this society, because this is it. Once we fix the men, once we fix the Christian man and get the Christian man to get off his butt and get out there and talk to other men and get them right. It's one at a time. Influence your environment. And your main environment right now is your family, is your wife. You get her, you get yourself right, your woman will be with you. She will. You can lead her and take her anywhere that the world can go, that can take you. But right now, you have to learn how to do that. And it's not going to be easy, but I'm here with you. I'm here with you. So, men, Christian man, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to you. Let's do this. You and me together. This is Jerry Jacobs Jr., Catholic Alphas, Marriage Unchained. Now go down here and subscribe, and let's take care of this. Bye.